handwriting, son. Good morning. My name is Sean Hudgeonwardle, and I will be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted with Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted with God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles, and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name. And each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, the Greek, nor the Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabets that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of the Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach according to the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have our class dedicated in prayer by Dr. LaShawn Love. And that will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson today will be Philippians chapter 1, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser.
Good morning, class.
Morning.
Let us bow our hearts and minds. Our Father, thank you for delivering us here this morning safely. May we each be able to absorb and take full advantage of your gospel. Please bless the speaker this morning And we thank you for all of your many blessings. Hallelujah.
Good morning, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from Philippians, the first chapter, page 262, and I'll be reading out the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum, Scripture Research Association Incorporated. Philippians, the first chapter. Saul and Timothy, the servants of Yahshua the Messiah, to all the signs in Yahshua the Messiah, which are at Philippi with the bishop and deacons, grace be unto you and peace from Yahweh our Father and from the Savior, Yahshua the Messiah. I thank my Elohim upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making requests with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he which has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Yahshua the Messiah. Even as it is fitting for me to think this of you all, because you have me in your heart, inasmuch as both in my bonds and in the defiance and confirmment of the gospel, ye all are partakers of this grace with me. For Yahweh is my witness how greatly I long after you all in the affection of Yahshua the Messiah. And this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment, that ye may examine the things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense till the day of the Messiah, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Yahshua the Messiah, unto the glory and praise of Yahweh. But I would ye should understand, brethren, that the things which happen unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel, so that my bonds in the Messiah are manifest in all the palace and in all other places. And many other brethren in the Messiah, waxing confident by my bonds, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach the Messiah even of envy and strife, and some also of goodwill. The one preached the Messiah of contention, not sincerely supposing to add affliction to my bonds, but the other of love, knowing that I am set for the defense of the gospel. What then, notwithstanding in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, the Messiah is preached, and I therein do rejoice, yea, and will rejoice. For I know that this shall turn to my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Yahshua the Messiah, according to my earnest expectation and my hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness, as always, so now also the Messiah shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. For to me to live is the Messiah, and to die is gain. But if I live in the flesh, this is to me the fruit of my labor. Yet what I shall choose, I know not. For I am in a strait betwixt the two. I will prefer the returning and be with the Messiah, which is far better. Nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. And having this confidence, I know that I should abide and continue with you all for your furtherance and joy of faith, that your rejoicing may be more abundant in Yahshua the Messiah for me by my coming to you again. Only let your behavior be as it becometh the evangel of the Messiah, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel, and be not terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an evident token of perdition, but to you of salvation and that of Elohim. For unto you it is given in the behalf of the Messiah, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which ye saw in me and now here to be in me. I have read Philippians, the first chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, LaShawn, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. I will be your first speaker for today's class. Normally, the moderator doesn't speak, but seeing that we're a little short today and I do have some things on my heart and mind, you know, then it's okay. We're a small class, and I'd just like to say that I appreciate the opportunity to be able to stand before the assembly of the body of Yahshua the Messiah and speak of anything that I've come to know and understand since coming into this class. Hey, kids, Ariel and Joshua. Ariel and Joshua, I need you to be quiet, okay? I'm happy to have my kids here. I want y'all to pay attention to what's being said. I haven't really been able to spend a lot of time with them since probably November of last year. It's been really busy for me, so I'm getting some time with them, and I'm really glad for that. I miss them very much. But anyhow, nevertheless, it's a good scripture lesson that we had today. You know, thinking about being in Yahshua the Messiah and coming out of the world, and, you know, in the scripture lesson, it speaks about not being terrified by your adversaries. And, you know, I remember before I came into this teaching, things could happen in my life. I could lose something. I could get an enemy who, you know, didn't like me. You know, I could be going through some kind of trial and tribulation, and, you know, it was kind of terrifying from time to time. And, you know, you get tougher, you do push-ups, you do pull-ups, you know, you learn how to fight. You learn how to manipulate situations. You learn how to lie and steal and cheat to get over, and you still have a fear that somebody's going to get the best of you because you don't really know a sure and concrete way to go. You just know the best that you know, and that's all you know when you're out in the world. And the beautiful thing about this doctrine is when you understand this pattern and how everything in the universe operates according to this pattern, and you've got one spirit in operation, which is the spirit of Yahweh, and you've got two mysteries, and they're both operating according to this pattern, then you can see what you're dealing with in every situation, and you no longer terrified by your adversaries. You no longer have to lie and cheat and steal and manipulate situations in order to get by, if that's what you think you're doing, you know. and it gives you a sense of peace, you know, because you can truly have something concrete that has integrity, that is sure, mm-hmm. You know, and you're not wavered to and fro by, you know, every wind of doctrine, if you will. It's been on my mind a lot about that adversary, about that mystery of iniquity, and I've been working on some things regarding, you know, the manifestation of the mystery of iniquity. And a couple weeks ago, we had a class where Noah and Ham was talked about. And when it was talked about, I was just like, I don't really know that much. You know, we hear about the story of Noah in the flood. I mean, that's a real popular biblical story or account. And Christendom really has done a whole lot, you know, as far as putting movies together and whatnot to kind of explain the story of Noah and the flood. But there was a comment. There's a part in there where it talks about after the flood is over with and Noah got drunk. And he, yeah, if you can give me that plate. Yeah. And it talked about Ham. You said it right there. Yeah, thank you very much. It talked about Ham spying out his father's nakedness. And I think it's in, what is it, Deuteronomy? Is it 27 and 20 or 23 and 20? Where it talks about that. And first, let's get it over in the fifth chapter. I think it's 5 and 29, Genesis 5 and 29, I believe it is. It's close to the end of that fifth chapter there. Let me see if I can find this. Deuteronomy 22 and 30 is. So if you can get. Is it in the sixth? Where it talks about Noah getting drunk. Oh. That's all the way down there? Mm-hmm. Is it 9 and 21? Is that what it is?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Could be wrong. There we go.
Genesis 9 and 18.
All right.
And the sons of Noah that went forth of the ark was Shem and Ham and Japheth. And Ham is the father of Canaan.
Mm-hmm.
These are the three sons of Noah, and of them was the whole earth overspread. And Noah began to be a husbandman, and he planted a vineyard.
Noah began to be a husbandman, and he planted a vineyard. So just keep that in mind. Go ahead and read.
And he drank of the wine and was drunken, and he was uncovered within his tent.
All right. He drank of the wine and was so he made a vineyard. He drank of the wine of the vineyard. He was uncovered. He was drunken and uncovered in his tent. Read.
And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brethren without. And Shem and Japheth took a garment and laid it upon both of their shoulders and went backwards and covered the nakedness of their father.
Okay. So Ham spied out the nakedness of his father, and his brothers weren't getting down with that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Now, what does that mean? That was the question that I had. What is this spying out the nakedness? Like, does anybody have an idea, I mean, of what that? Or what do you think that means? Because that was my question. And when you go over to 22 and 30 of Deuteronomy, it talks about spying out the nakedness of the of thy father.
Mm-hmm.
So let's read that there and let's find out what it means to be spying out his nakedness. Because, you know, you see right here. You see a pictorial illustration that looks like that's Noah laid out and getting covered up.
Right.
But let's read and see what it says in the scriptures about thy father's nakedness. Go ahead.
Deuteronomy 22:30.
Mm-hmm.
A man shall not take his father's wife nor uncover his father's skirt. Should I go?
Keep on, yeah, keep reading for a second. Let me see if that's...
That's 30.
That's it?
Yeah.
All right, and then there's... is it 27 in? Let me see. I have a hard time putting all of these scriptures all together. So bear with me here. Once I get it going, I'll be all right. 27 and 20. Yes, please.
Cursed be he that lieth with his father's wife, because he uncovered his father's skirt, and all the people shall say, so be it.
All right. Leviticus.
Right, okay.
18 and 8.
Leviticus 18 and 8.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want me to start 7?
You can.
The nakedness of thy father or the nakedness of thy mother shall thou not uncover. She is thy mother. Thou shalt not uncover her nakedness. The nakedness of thy father's wife shall thou not uncover. It is thy father's nakedness.
The nakedness of thy father's wife thou shalt not uncover. It is the father's nakedness.
Right.
So, you know, it's kind of one of those things where you can just skip over what it's talking about in Genesis, where Ham spied out his father's nakedness. Now, when Noah discovered what was going on with Ham, he cursed Ham. He said that it's no good. He was mad as all get out at Ham. Now, I'm a guy, and I know Ham was a guy. And if I was Ham's father, and I was drunk and naked in my tent, I wouldn't give two shakes about him coming in and seeing whatever I got, because I know what I got. Same thing he got. We walk around the locker room. You know, we two men. So there's really not a consequence for you seeing another man in his nakedness. So there had to be something that was wrong that happened that Noah wouldn't like. Now, this is after the flood that this is happening. So the earth has been ultimately destroyed, save those that were in the ark. And the eight souls that were in the ark and the animals that went into the ark as well. And Noah at this time is likened unto the king or the ruler. He's in charge. He's the one who had the vision. He's the one who preached. He's the one who facilitated putting together this ark according to the will of Yahweh and by the instruction, the divine instruction of Yahweh. He didn't do it on his own. I don't want you to think that I'm trying to get that across. But yet and still, he's the patriarch here. So understanding that the nakedness of thy father's wife is thy father's nakedness, and perceiving and understanding that Ham, while Noah was drunk and not paying attention, he got caught slipping, if you will, that's how we call it. He went and spied out his father's naked. He went in on Noah's wife. And that's what the mystery of iniquity in Satan does. See, Noah's the ruler. Noah's in charge right now. And what Satan wants to do is he wants to be in charge. He wants to be the Most High. And that's what Ham is doing here. Is by taking his wife, he's trying to knock Noah down. Now, we got over the same thing that happens with Solomon and Adoniah, their brothers, in 1 Kings. And you can, I mean, if we got time. All right. Let's go over to 1 Kings in the first chapter, there's a little bit of reading to do. If we can get through the reading, we can really nail down what I'm talking about here with the spying out the father's nakedness.
First King 1:1.
Yes. And I'm just going to let you read. You can turn the camera on her. It's a little bit of reading.
Now, King David was old and stricken in years, and they covered him with clothes, but he could not become warm. Wherefore, his servant said unto him, let there be sought for my master, the king, a young virgin, and let her stand before the king, and let her cherish him, and let her lie in thy bosom, that my master, the king, may get heat. So they sought for a fair damsel throughout all the coast of Israel, and found Abishag, and a Shunammite, and brought her to the king. And the damsel was very fair and cherished the king and ministered to him, but the king knew her not.
Okay, so Abishag was a very fair damsel, and the king, King David, he was old, he was weak, he couldn't keep body heat, so they sought after a woman to keep him warm, to keep him alive, to give him life. And this woman is likened unto a wife, but he was too old to lay with her. That's why he said he knew her not. Go ahead and read.
Then Adonijah, the son of Haggith, exalted himself, saying, I will be king. And he prepared him a chariot and horsemen and 50 men to run before him.
Now Adonijah exalted himself and said, I will be king. And that is King David's son at the time. Read.
And his father had not displeased him at any time in saying, why hast thou done so? And he also was a very goodly man. And his mother bare him after Absalom. And he conferred with Joab, the son of Zeruiah, mm-hmm. and with Abiathar, the priest, mm-hmm. and they following Adonijah helped him. Mm-hmm. But Zadok, the priest, and Benaiah, the son of
Jehoiada.
Yeah. And Nathan, the prophet, and Shimei, and Rai, and the mighty men which belonged to David were not with Adonijah.
So there were some people who went along with what Adonijah had going on. King David never told Adonijah what to do or what not to do. But there were still some that did not follow what Adonijah was trying to accomplish, saying, just declaring within himself that I'm going to be king, exalting himself. Go ahead and continue to read.
And Adonijah slew sheep and oxen and fat cattle by the stone of Zohelath, which is by Erogel, and called all his brethren, the king's son, and all the men of Judah, the king's servants. But Nathan the prophet and Benaiah, and the mighty man, and Solomon his brother, he called not. Wherefore Nathan spake unto Bathsheba, the mother of Solomon, saying, hast thou not heard that Adonijah, the son of Haggith, does reign, and David, our master, knoweth not?
So Adonijah called all his clique and all his crew and everybody who he knew was going to be on his side and wasn't going to give him heat, wasn't going to give him any kind of resistance in what he did, and to have a feast. He slew sheep and oxen and cattle and, you know, set this whole thing up. But his brother Solomon and Benaiah and, you know, all these other people, he didn't call. So it start getting out like, well, what's going on? Like, we know that there's something happening. We haven't been invited to this feast. This is what we're reading here. Go ahead and read on.
Now, therefore, come, let me, I pray thee, give thee counsel that thou mayest save thine own life and the life of thy son Solomon. Go and get thee in unto King David and say unto him, didst not thou, my master, O king, swear unto thy handmaid, saying, assuredly Solomon thy son shall reign after me, and he shall sit upon my throne. Why then doth Adonijah reign?
So it had been declared by King David that upon the demise of him, of King David, that Solomon would take over the throne. But Adonijah, exalting himself, decided that he was going to be the one. Adonijah already knew that Solomon was supposed to take the throne, but he's, what do you call that, a coup, basically? He's trying to, yeah, he was an older son. Adonijah was the older son, and he was just, he decided that he was going to be the one that was going to be in charge. So we're going to find, so they're saying, well, we need to go to King David and find out what's really going on, because Adonijah's taken over and King David doesn't know about it. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read.
Behold, while thou yet talkest there with the king, I also will come in after thee and confirm thy words. And Bathsheba went in unto the king into the chamber, and the king was very old. And Abishag the Shunammite ministered unto the king. And Bathsheba bowed and did obedience unto the king. And the king said, what wouldest thou? And she said unto him, my master, thou swearest by Yahweh thy Elohim unto thy handmaid, saying, assuredly Solomon the son shall reign after me, and he shall sit upon my throne. And now, behold, Adonijah reign, and now my master, the king, thou knowest is not. And he has slain oxen and fat cattle and sheep in the abundance, and has called all the sons of the king, and Abathar the priest, and Job, and the captain of the host, but Solomon thy servant has he not called. And thou, my master, O king, the eye of all Israel are upon thee, that thou shouldest tell them who shall sit on the throne of my master, the king, after him. Otherwise it shall come to pass, when my master, the king, shall sleep with his fathers, that I and my son Solomon shall be counted offenders. And lo, while she yet talked with the king, Nathan the prophet also came in. And they told the king, saying, behold, Nathan the prophet. And when he was come in before the king, he bowed himself before the king with his face to the ground. And Nathan said, my master, O king, hast thou said Adonijah shall reign after me, and he shall sit upon my throne? For he is gone down this day and has slain oxen and fat cattle and sheep in abundance, and has called all the king's sons and the captains of the host and Abathar the priest. And behold, they eat and drink before him and say, long live King Adonijah. But me, even me, thy servant, and Zadok the priest, and Benaiah the son of Jehoiab, and they, thy servant Solomon, has he not called? Is this thing done by my master the king, and thou hast not shown it unto thy servant, who should sit on the throne of my masters the king after him?
So they ask, and they wondering, like, hey, so what's going on? Adonijah's taken over. Solomon was supposed to be the king. Well, you know, do you know what's going on? Did you say that Adonijah was going to be in control? What do you rule? What do you decree? Go ahead and read. And I'm going to have you skip down in a minute so we save some time. I can kind of paraphrase some things, but go ahead and read.
Then King David answered and said, call me Bathsheba. And she came into the king's presence and stood before the king. Mm-hmm. And the king sware and said, as Yahweh liveth, that hath redeemed my soul out of all distress, even as I swear unto thee by Yahweh Elohim of Israel, saying, assuredly Solomon thy son shall reign after me.
Sure. So King David is saying, okay, well, we need to stop all of this because assuredly Solomon, thy son, shall reign after me. Read.
And he shall sit upon my throne in my stead.
Mm-hmm.
Even so will I certainly do this day.
Right. Read.
Then Bathsheba bowed with her face to the earth and did reverence to the king and said, let my master King David live forever.
Now, they're pleased with what King David had to say. Now, King David is about to set up his own thing. Adoniah's got his thing set up. Now, let's read right here what King David said to be done.
And King David said, call me Zadok the priest,
mm-hmm.
and Nathan the prophet, and Benaiah the son of Jehoiada.
Now, those are people that Adoniah didn't invite to the party.
Right.
Go ahead.
And they came before the king.
Mm-hmm.
And the king also said unto them, take with you the servant of your masters and cause Solomon, my son, to ride upon my own mule.
Right.
And bring him down to Gihon.
So go get Solomon and put him upon his mule and bring him down to Gihon. Read.
And let Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet anoint him their king over Israel. And blow ye with the trumpet and say, long live King Solomon.
All right. So, David just said, we're going to cancel all of that right now. David is still the king at this point in time. He said, go ahead right now. Go get David. Put him on the mule. Bring him on to Gihon. Anoint him and put him in a place. Set him on the throne of King David. He's going to get his inheritance right now so that it doesn't come to pass after King David passes that Adoniah just rules by force. And he wants the people to know that Solomon is going to take over. Now, at this same time, Adoniah's already got his situation playing out. He's already slew the beast, and he's got the feast together, and he's got the priest and his company of people getting set up for a party. So they're having this party here with Adoniah to get him together, and they hear Solomon down in Gihon in a loud trumpet being blown, and yeah, I guess we could just go ahead and read it. All right, go ahead and keep on reading it. Yep.
Then ye shall come up after him, that he may come and sit upon my throne.
Mm-hmm.
For he shall be king in my stead,
mm-hmm.
and I have appointed him to be ruler over Israel and over Judah. And Benaiah the son of Jehoiada answered the king and said, so be it, Yahweh Elohim of my master the king, say so too. As Yahweh has been with my master the king, even so be he with Solomon, and make his throne greater than the throne of my master King David. And Zadok the priest, and Nathan the prophet, and Benaiah the son of Jehoiada, and the Chesarhites and the Pelahites went down and called Solomon to ride upon King David's mule and brought him to Gihon. And Zadok the priest took a horn of oil out of the tabernacle and anointed Solomon. And they blew the trumpet, and all the people said, long live King Solomon. And all the people came up after him, and the people piped with pipes and rejoiced with great joy,
mm-hmm.
so that the earth rent with the sound of them.
So it was a great noise. Read.
And Adoniah and all the guests that was with him heard it as they had made an end of eating.
So they were already partying and eating and being merry and drinking the wine and whatnot. And they heard that great noise. They heard the trumpet. They heard the whole kingdom come together in a great noise and the thunderings and whatnot. And they want to know what's up. Read. Mm-hmm.
And when Joab heard the sound of the trumpet, he said, wherefore is this noise of the city being an uproar? And while he yet spake, behold, Jonathan, the son of Abiathar, the priest came. And Adoniah said unto him, come in, for thou art a valiant man, and bringest good tidings. And Jonathan answered and said to Adonijah, "Verily, our master King David has made Solomon king, and the king has sent with him Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet and Benaiah the son of Jehoiada and the Cherethites and the Pelethites, and they have caused him to ride upon the king's mule. And Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet have anointed him king in Gohan. And they are come up from thence rejoicing, so that the city rang again. This is the noise that ye have heard. And also Solomon sitteth on the throne of the kingdom. And moreover, the king's servant came to bless our master King David, saying, Elohim make the name of Solomon better than thy name, and make this throne greater than thy throne. And the king bowed himself upon the bed. And also thus said king, Blessed be Yahweh, the Elohim of Israel, which has given one to sit on my throne this day, my eyes even seeing it. And all the guests that were with Adonijah was afraid.
They were scared. They were because they know they done messed up. They in the wrong household now. You know, King David set the record straight. But go ahead and read.
And all the guests that was with Adonijah was afraid and rose up and went every man his way.
Mm-hmm.
And Adonijah feared because of Solomon and arose and went and caught hold on the horns of the altar.
So he clutching his pearls. You know, he don't know what to do because he knew he was going to set himself up and become king, but he didn't know that he was going to turn around on him like this. Mm-hmm. But anyhow, go ahead and continue to read.
And it was told Solomon, saying, Behold, Adonijah feareth King Solomon.
Everybody's seen it. Mm-hmm. Everybody's seen it. So the word got back to Solomon that Adonijah was scared. Anyhow, go ahead, read.
For lo, he has caught hold on the horns of the altar, saying, Let King Solomon swear unto me today that he will not slay his servant with the sword. And Solomon said, If he will show himself a worthy man, there shall not a hair of him fall to the earth. But if wickedness shall be found in him, he shall die. So King
Solomon says straight up, he said, I'm not going to kill him as long as he's a worthy man and he's not a wicked man. And he doesn't do wicked things. You know, don't be scared. Just do what you're supposed to do. Don't, you know. And we can let bygones be bygones, if you will. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read, though.
So King Solomon sent, and they brought him down from the altar. And he came and bowed himself to King Solomon. And Solomon said unto him, Go to thine house.
Adonijah came down to the altar, bowed himself to King Solomon, so he recognized Solomon's authority at this time. And Solomon said, go ahead, go on about your business. He didn't touch a hair on his head. He was a man of his word, just the way that, you know, just the way that he said he would be. Now, it goes on and it talks about David passing. Do we want to continue read? Because we got the time, because there's in this next chapter is really where it gets to the point that I'm trying to get to here with this mystery of iniquity. So let's go ahead and continue reading.
Now the days of David drew nigh that he should die, and he charged Solomon his son, saying, I go the way of all the earth, but thou strong, therefore, and show thyself a man, and keep the charge of Yahweh thy Elohim to walk in his way, to keep his statutes and his commandments and his judgments and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, that thou mayest prosper in all that thou doest, whithersoever thou turnest thyself, that Yahweh may continue his word which he spake concerning me, saying, If thy children take heed to their way, to walk before me in truth, with all thy heart and with all thy soul, there shall not fail thee, said he, a man on the throne of Israel. Moreover, thou knowest also what Joab, the son of Zeruiah, did to me, and what he did to the two captains of the host of Israel, unto Abner the son of Ner, and unto Amasa, the son of Jether, whom he slew, and shed the blood of war in peace, and put the blood of war upon his girdle that was about his loins, and in his shoes that was on his feet. Do therefore according to thy wisdom, and let not his hoar head go down to the grave in peace. But show kindness unto the son of Barzella and Galilite, and let them be of those that eat at thy table. For so they came to me when I fled because of Absalom thy brother. And behold, thou hast with thee Shimei the son of Gera, a Benjamite of Bahurim, which cursed me with a grievous curse in the day when I went to Mahanaim. But he came down to meet me at Jordan, and I swear to him by Yahweh, saying, I will not put thee to death with the sword.
Okay, go ahead and skip down to 16. So David passed. David tells Solomon how he wants the kingdom ran, how, you know, gave him the advice, whatever, that he could give him. Let's skip down to 16 here, because what I want to get to is whether Adoniah is being a good man or if he's got wickedness in his heart. And we can get to that here.
And now I ask one petition of thee, deny me not.
This is Adoniah speaking, but go ahead.
And she said unto him, say on. And he said, speak, I pray thee, unto Solomon the king, for he will not say thee nay.
Now, Adoniah is asking Bathsheba to go to Solomon the king to petition for him. Go ahead.
That he give me Abishag the Shunammite to wife.
Now, Abishag is who he's at. He said, this is the only thing that I wanted a king. He said, I've recognized Solomon as king, and the only thing that I want from this mighty king is Abishag. He ain't going to do nothing with Abishag is what he's kind of trying to get. Solomon's not going to do anything with Abishag. She's a very right. fair woman, but she's likened unto the wife of King David. But what was, yes, sorry, I'll get you a mic. Here you go.
Since Abishag was the wife of David,
mm-hmm.
and his son, the older son,
mm-hmm. Adoniah,
he can become a king because he have the wife, because after the father is dead, he can have the wives.
Mm-hmm.
Or the brothers, if you have a brother, you can marry his wife if he's dead,
mm-hmm.
but now he is alive according to the Hebrews law. So Adoniah, being the oldest and have Abishag as a wife, he can become a king. This is why Solomon sent someone to kill.
This is what we're going to get. That's a spoiler alert right there, because that's what we're going to get to. And that's basically what happens here. We can go ahead and continue reading. We're going to get to that.
And Bathsheba said, well, I will speak for thee unto the king. Bathsheba therefore went unto King Solomon to speak unto him for Adoniah. And the king rose up to meet her and bowed himself unto her and sat down on his throne and caused a seat to be set for the king's mother. And she sat on his right hand. Then she said, I desire one small petition of thee. I pray thee, say me not nay. And the king said unto her, ask on, my mother, for I will not say thee nay. And she said, let Abishag the Shunammite be given to Adoniah thy brother to wife. And King Solomon answered and said unto his mother, and why dost thou ask Abishag the Shunammite for Adoniah? Ask for him the kingdom also, for he is my elder brother, even for him, and for Abathar the priest, and for Joab the son of Jeruah. Then King Solomon swear by Yahweh,
so,
saying.
So, hold on. We don't want to skip over that, because the response of King Solomon at the point that she asked Abishag for Adonijah, he said, why not ask for the kingdom also? Mm-hmm. Why, you're going to ask for Abishag. Why not ask for the kingdom also? And that's exactly what Dr. Samuel Silas was saying, is that if he gets Abishag, and he's toting around the king's wife, that's the queen. Mm-hmm. So even though Solomon has been anointed, he's on the throne and everything, according to the rules and the way the Hebrew customs and tradition, Adonijah having the king's wife, he can usurp his authority as king because he's got the queen. And that's his way of Adonijah's way of manipulating the situation so that he can continue to exalt himself. And that is a manifestation of that mystery of iniquity, or Satan exalting himself. What is that? Isaiah 45 and 45, is that what it is? Where he talks about, I will exalt myself on the sides of the north. I will be like the Most High. Is that what it is? No, it's not 45. It's 14. Yeah. It might be. It's one of them. It could be Ezekiel or
Isaiah. No, 14.
No, it's 14 and 14 and 12.
12.
Isaiah 14 and 12.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning?
How art thou fallen from heaven? How? Read.
How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nation?
Mm-hmm.
For thou hast said in thy heart.
Now this is what Lucifer said in his heart. Read.
I will ascend into heaven.
Mm-hmm.
I will exalt my throne above the stars of El.
I will exalt my throne above the stars of El. And when we look over here on the ages and dispensations chart, I really appreciate in the creative, in the first age on this chart, where it shows this dotted line in between the angelic and the physical creation, and showing that it shows that they working together. So whatever is happening in the angelic creation, there's a manifestation, there's a type and shadow of it happening in the physical creation. And what you got over in Romans 1:19 and 20 is, so it says that the invisible things of the angelic creation, the invisible things from the creation of the world, are clearly seen by the things that are made. So when we're reading over here in 1 Kings about Adonijah and Solomon being a goodly child, and Solomon being to inherit the throne, but Adonijah not to be inherited throne, he's exalting himself. He's doing the exact same thing that Satan said that he would do. Lucifer said that he would do. Go ahead and continue to read in Isaiah.
I will sit also upon the mountain will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north.
On the sides of the north, the mount on the north side, that's the side of the judges. So he's going to be the judge. He's going to be the ruler, making all of the rules around town. That's where we talking about the kingdom of the law of Moses that was out here in the wilderness. There were 12 tribes that camped on the four sides of this tabernacle, and on the north side is the side of the judges. That's what I'm talking about with that there. But go ahead and read.
I will ascend above the heights of the cloud. I will be like the Most High.
He will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Now, over in, there's another reference to that spying out thy father's nakedness in 1 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 5 and 1.
1 Corinthians 5 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
It is reported commonly that there is fornication among you, such fornication as is not so much as mentioned among the Gentiles, that one should have his father's wife. And ye are puffed up, and have not rather mourned, that he that done this deed might be taken away from among you.
So that fornication is people. There, it was rumors that people were doing that, and it's not right. You take it. That's fornication. That's against that law of Moses. You know, you don't do that. What Ham was doing back here. He's not going into the tent looking at Noah. Somebody might argue with me, but all over the book, it's spying out his father's nakedness, and that's a problem. Ham trying to rule and be the ruler, he raped Noah's wife. He raped her. When the brothers seen it, they were ashamed. They didn't look on her. They covered her up.
Right.
Noah seen it. He said, "You cursed." And that's what Satan does. Satan is trying to take Yahweh's wife. Adam and Eve out here in the garden. Adam was given the law, and the law was just to tend to the garden, but stay away from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He didn't have no business being in the midst of the garden. He knew it. And read over in Genesis 5 and 1. Because when this law was given, Eve hadn't really came on the scene as she looks right here. But go ahead and read.
This is Genesis 5 and 1.
Yeah.
This is the book of the generation of Adam.
Mm-hmm.
In the day that Elohim created man.
Read.
In the likeness of Elohim made he him.
He made man in the likeness of Elohim, like we say in the moderation. This Elohistic shape and form, he took on shape and form, and man was made in the same likeness and image of Elohim with flesh and blood. Elohim is without flesh and blood. But read.
Male and female created he them.
Wait. Male and female created he them. Read.
And blessed them and called their name Adam.
Called their name. Adam. Now we know when Eve was drawn out of Adam. So this confirms right here that when Adam was created in a hermaphroditic state, male and female. They're not going to say that. They're not going to agree with that out in the world in Christendom. No, it ain't right. But it had to be that way. Eve had to be in Adam. Because it had to show forth that he was made up the same way as Yahweh Elohim, not needing to go outside of himself to create anything. He had to be both male and female. The name Yahweh, which is right here, I ain't got to go over there, is masculine and feminine right within himself. And when you read in the scriptures, when you see Yahweh and you just see the without the way, just the YAH, the way is assumed. It's in there. It's just hidden within. Just like Eve was hidden within the man. So when that law was given to Adam not to partake of this fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, Eve was there. She was within Adam. That's the reason why I'm even bringing that part up. But let me get my train of thought back here. I just lost it for a second. So Satan, when he was in his garden, he seen Adam, and Adam is Yahweh Elohim. That's the Son of Man in the flesh. He couldn't approach Adam and convince him of anything because he knew what was up. Eve, on the other hand, she was subject to that vanity. That is Yahweh's wife. And he approached Yahweh's wife. He didn't approach Adam. Adonijah approached David's wife. He tried to backhand get David's wife. He was going to the women. He went to Bathsheba. He didn't stand up like a man and go straight to Solomon with the request, the petition to be to get Abishag. No, he went through the woman. He's trying to go through the woman to get to the man. That's what Satan is doing, is to exalt, like it's over in the 14th chapter of Isaiah. He's doing whatever he can. He know he can't go straight up to the man. He gonna knock him down. There ain't no future in that front. But maybe if he can go this back door all around the mulberry bush or whatever, he can get to the man by the woman. And he did. He did, because she partook of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and she gave it to her husband. And him knowing that this was something that she wasn't supposed to partake of, he died willingly for his bride. He went through all of this to draw, and this is the will of Yahweh. See, Dr. Kinley, he would say it, that Satan is an asset to Yahweh. He is not a liability. And I mean, I tell you, you go into the church and they mad at Eve and they mad at Adam for doing why I gotta go to work today, because Eve done partook of the tree of knowledge. But see, we wouldn't have been able to draw out this creation and be where we are. Joe Williams used to say it all the time. You are not going to have the illumination of a light bulb without a positive and a negative electrical charge. If they would have stayed up here in the Garden of Eden, and there wouldn't have been a transgression or a coming out, then there would have been no purpose for the man to be created in the first place. It would have just been blah. It would have always just been Adam and Eve, and there would have been no reason for procreation. There would be no need for salvation, and therefore there would be no purpose. And we are coming back to a knowledge and understanding of who our Heavenly Father is according to his purpose. And his purpose had to be drawn out. And it was drawn out according to a pattern. And the plan is to bring us back, the sons back. Not that son of perdition, but that son of righteousness, to back to a knowledge and understanding of who we are and how we actually exist in righteousness, joy, and peace. As is read, like referring again, not being terrified by our adversaries. I'm not scared of this. I got plenty of stuff going on. I'm not worried about it. There's plenty of negative things going on in my life right now. I'm not worrying about it because I know according to the promise that Yahweh has given his sons, it's going to be all right. It's going to work out. I might not see what's happening, but I know according to every step that I take along the way, I see righteousness, peace, and joy, as long as I operate with integrity. I could be doing the backdoor Abishag deal, trying to get along and get the wife. And, you know, that would be unto my destruction, because we didn't read on Adonijah was slain. He had Adonijah slain for asking for Abishag, because he knew he was trying to play. And that's not, you know, let me see. There's another story. Another account And that's in the book of Esther. We're not going to read all of that. But I want to talk about the book of Esther. And it's the same situation. And let me see if I can get over there, because with the names, it's really hard for me. let me find out. I think it's in about 600 something. But there it is right here. Esther's a pretty small book. And there's only 10 chapters. So it's kind of good for you to read this story if you haven't read it before. But in the book Esther, there was a king, and his name was Ahasuerus. And this is during the time of the Medes and the Persians. And he was having a feast, and he had all of the princes from around, from Mede and Persia, come and to celebrate and to be merry. And he called his wife at the time. He had a wife, and she was a very beautiful woman. He called his wife at the time to come down and, you know, present herself on the king, next to the king, so that everybody could look on her beauty. And that wife, I can't remember her name, but she said, "No, I'm not coming down there."
What? Vashti.
Vashti. Yeah, she said she's not coming. She said she's not coming down there. Yeah, everybody was drunk. Everybody was partying. And she said she wasn't coming down there to be with the king. And, I mean, king is the authority. And he's giving a rule. He's saying what to do. And she's saying, "I'm not going to do it." So that kind of made him feel like, well, you know, what kind of woman is this? She making me look bad in front of my boys. You know, I got the grill going and the music playing and everything. I mean, we drinking and having a good time. I called for it. She said, "I'm not coming down there." So his counsel said, "Get rid of her. She no good. Get rid of her. Get you another wife. And if you don't, then all of the wives all throughout the kingdoms aren't going to respect their husband anymore. The man is not, is just, she's going to set a precedent that it does, the man don't have to listen to the wife." And the king was pleased with that advice, because he wasn't happy with Vashti. And he went looking for another virgin. And all of these virgins were presented to him. And Esther came and was presented before the king. And the king found favor with Esther. And Esther was related to Mordecai. And Esther was a Jew. She was a Hebrew. And Mordecai was a Jew as well. So when Esther found favor with the king, she was ultimately declared queen, and Vashti is out of here. So throughout the land, that authority of the king stood strong, that the man is the head of the household, if you will. And Esther, now being the queen, is in the king's chambers or what have you. Now, time goes on. And what was that guy? Haman. Haman is brought up in power. He's like the king's right-hand man. What's that? One of his main advisors. So Haman is coming up in the ranks. And everybody throughout the land is bowing down to Haman. Hey, Haman is the bee's knees, if you will. But Mordecai didn't bow down to Haman. When Haman would walk by in the courtyard and whatnot, Haman didn't like that. Haman got pissed off when it was brought to his attention that Mordecai wasn't paying and giving reverence to Haman. He was like, "No, we're not having that." Haman wanted to be exalted. just like Adonijah wanted to be exalted, just like that Lucifer out here in the Garden of Eden wanted to be exalted, just like what we read over there in Isaiah, that exaltation. So he got a little problem with Mordecai. Now, Mordecai was a good dude, though. Mordecai was out there at the gates, and he overheard some people, some of the guards at the gates, talking about overthrowing the king. And he relayed that information so that those guys were taken out of the equation, so that it wouldn't be a mutiny, if you will, in the kingdom. Now, Haman don't know nothing about that. It was brought to the king's attention that it happened, but he didn't really have time to, you know, deal with it because he's the king and he's got a lot of things and it was taken care of as good. You know, Haman being all pissed off because Mordecai is not bowing down to him, he's trying to figure out a way to get Mordecai out of here. And what he does is he's trying to get Mordecai hung. And he approaches the king to have all of the Hebrews throughout all of the lands and all of the kingdoms to be slain because they're not bowing down to Haman. And he's thinking in it like, hey, if y'all not gonna bow down, y'all might raise up. That's the exact same, something like what the Pharaoh down here in Egypt said when he put the death decree out on the people. He said, oh, the children of Israel, they're growing mighty and they might overthrow us one day. We need to get rid of some of them. That exact same thing. And we know you coming down to these classes, if you ever listen to the migratory trek out of the land of Egypt, where Pharaoh represents Satan. That's another representation of Satan in that self-exalting. So we got Haman here, and he approaches the king and he asks him in a smooth, slick way, hey, can you do this for me? The king gives him his ring to seal this decree. And there's a decree that's put out and is sent to all of the nations under the kingdom to slay the Jews or the Hebrews. Now, word gets back to Esther because Mordecai gets word of it first. And Mordecai, he rents his clothes and he gets dressed in sackcloth, looking like, you know, a wild man. And he goes down there and he's wailing and crying and protesting that this thing is happening. And then the word of Mordecai being outside the gates, because you couldn't come in the gates dressed in, you had to be dressed in proper raiment. It's just like going into a courtroom, if you will. You know, you got to be dressed properly to go into a courtroom. Nowadays, in the way that we have law, you can walk into a courtroom with regular clothes. But back in maritime law and whatnot, you couldn't go in. You had to have a powder wig on. You had to have certain attire on. You would get kicked out. You'll get thrown to, you know, you'll get thrown in jail trying to come into a courtroom in common clothes with your coveralls on or whatever, you know. And that's the way that it was in the kingdom. You had to be in proper attire to get into the gates of the court there. Now, he's dressed in sackcloth. It worries Esther because she's like, I don't want my, you know, Mordecai to be, my people to get messed up out here because he run around looking crazy. Send him some clothes. He refused the clothes. Mm-hmm. And then she's like, why is that happening? So he said, sent the message back. Hey, this is what's going on. There's a decree. Here's a copy of the letter, the decree to kill the Jews. She reads it. She said, I'm a Jew. Mm-hmm. So if it comes down that this decree actually takes place, then she could get slew as well. So she approaches, she figures a way to approach the king, and she gambles her life to save herself and her family, because the king had not called for her. And the only time you're supposed to approach the king when he's doing his business is if he calls for you. And so she approached the king. Now, when she approached the king, if he didn't hold out his scepter to accept her, then she would have been slayed right then and there on the spot. Head chopped off. But he did. He found favor with her. He held out his scepter. He heard her. She invited him for like a feast meal or whatever. And she invited Haman to come along with as well. So the message was given to Haman that it was going to be like a private party. Come on down, Haman. And the king and the queen together, and he's all happy and feeling all good about himself. Yeah, I'm coming up in the world. We're having a private party. I'm doing a good job. He don't realize that Mordecai, you know, he's an inside guy because he's always on the outside of the gate. So he don't know what's going on. But to shorten it up a little bit, Haman comes in. And they have this gathering, and Esther tells the king that there's this decree that is to slay all of the Hebrews. And how did it go? The word had gotten to the king about Mordecai. Given the word about these guys that were trying to slay the king, trying to overthrow the kingdom. So before this meetup, this dinner that Esther sets up, Haman approaches the king because he's trying to get rid of Mordecai. He's doing all kinds of stuff to get rid of Mordecai. He's obsessed with this thing. Mm. Now, the king had just had a conversation about Mordecai. And when Haman approaches him, he asks for Haman's advice, as Haman being an advisor. What would you do he asked Haman, what would you do with the person that well pleases the king? And Haman said, Haman said, yeah, I'll hook him up. I'll put him on the horse and, you know, get him all draped up and parade him in front of all of the people and, you know, represent him in all the kingdoms and you know, exalt him. And Haman, in his own egotistical, misdirected personality, is thinking that the king is setting up the deal for Haman to get put up on the throne and you know, and be exalted and whatnot. But he's really talking about Mordecai. So when he said, okay, well, if that's what you would do, then that's what we're going to do. Go get Mordecai. Go get Mordecai and do all of that stuff that you said that you would do. And Haman's like way pissed. He's like, hey, hold on. This is a guy that I'm trying to get rid of. So y'all going, all right, I'll do what you're the king, so I got to do. So he did everything that the king said that he would do and Mordecai all draped up and everything. And then the feast came along with Esther and the king, and it came out. Esther approached the king about this decree to kill the Jews, the Hebrews. And it was made known to the king that Haman had evil in his heart, that he was trying to slay these Jews. So it turned, the whole thing turned around on this Haman for trying to exalt himself. And Haman ended up being slain. And his 10 sons were slain as well. They basically wiped his name out of the book of life. I mean, like, his whole family was wiped out. And there was a festival every year, like, because the Jews, there was another decree that was put out for the Jews to defend themselves on that same day that Haman had decreed for everybody to be all the Hebrews to be destroyed. And Mordecai was put in Haman's place. Yeah. Esther was actually given that charge of the house of Haman. And Mordecai was made unto an advisor and things like that. And it just shows the reason why I'm talking about this whole thing is because it shows Haman as the mystery of iniquity, or Satan trying to exalt himself, trying to get himself up and work his way around and get himself into power in any way that he can to exalt himself above the king. He wants to be like the Most High. And let me see. Is there anything? Yeah. So, what am I thinking?
He make another party. The king make another party, invite Mordecai. When the king went away, Mordecai tried to say something.
Let me give you a mic.
So, they were another party. All the friends, they were there. And Mordecai also. And the king went somewhere to bring something. And Mordecai tried to tell the queen, why are you doing those things against me? But he was so close and looked like he was holding her. And when the king see that, he said, oh, he messing around with my wife. So the king killed him for that reason.
Mordecai.
Yeah, they killed Mordecai and put him in a stick.
Oh, I didn't get that far.
This is why I say keep going.
Yeah. So I've been reading, I've been investigating. I didn't get that far.
Oh, that's pretty good.
Yeah, so I'm gonna have to keep on reading a little bit more. But I was just looking at I was looking at that principle of Haman there, and him exalting himself, and when we get a reader or whatnot, we'll have Ezekiel 28. And we was talking about it, so we might as well, get it.
What?
28 and 17.
Oh.
Where is it at?
New one 12.
Wait a second.
The king of Tyres.
Let me see.
13. Been in Eden.
Let's start at 13. That's fine.
Ezekiel 28:13. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of Elohim. Every precious stone was thy covering. The sardis, the topaz, and the diamond. The beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle and gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of Elohim. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created till iniquity was found in thee.
Until iniquity was found in him. We're talking about Satan. And he says, thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. And when we talk about the pattern and everything being made according to the pattern of the tabernacle, you've got your gate. Your first step, your brazen altar sin offering is your second step. Your third step is the brazen laver. Your fourth step is the holy cup of anointing oil at the door to the holy place of the tabernacle. Your fifth step is the entire interior of the holy place containing the seven branch candle lampstand, the table of shewbread, and the altar of incense representing light bread and intercessor. And then your sixth step is this second compartmental veil, which covers up the seventh step, which is the holy place, or the most holy place in that tabernacle. Now, that anointing cherub that covereth is on this sixth step of the veil. So when you go over into Revelations where it talks about here's wisdom, that the number of a man is 666, is pointing to that sixth number of the number of the beast, but it says the number of the man is the beast man of sin. Because see, this, you got to get past this to understand something about this. As long as this is in the way, you can't know nothing about this. You got your own ideas, and you know, you got the food that you like to eat according to the palate and taste buds of your mouth, and you think that's good. You know, I'm struggling with them two kids right now because they like trans fat and, you know, sugar and, you know, all this stuff like that. And in their mind, they think that's what's good for them. But they got low on energy, you know, more fat. Their bodies aren't really, you know, handling that bad food. And I give them the best food that I can give them. I'm not always in control of what they eat. So, you know, there's nothing I can do about it. But what man thinks isn't what Yahweh thinks. And his way are higher than our ways. Now, the reason why I'm even bringing that up, because we're talking about this anointed cherub that covers, that exalts himself above Yahweh. He wants to be like the Most High. You go to, I was a cool kid for a while. You go to New York, them guys call themselves gods. You are a god. You know, everything. And I mean, undoubtedly, you are what you're looking for. Each and every one of us is a manifestation of Yahweh. Dr. Williams used to say, we are a microcosm of the greater macrocosm. And if you break it all the way down into the periodic table of elements, like Dr. Samuel Silas was talking about on Thursday, you've got that atom. And it's threefold just like you are. You got a head cavity, a chest cavity, and an abdominal cavity. You can live without these arms and the legs. They're non-consequential to your life. You got to have this head, chest, and abdominal. Those three must be one in order for this physical body to have life. An atom, a nuclear atom, has to have the proton, the neutron, and the electron. Those three have to be there in order to have that atom. The neutron is invisible. That neutron represents that most holy place. Who's covering it up? Hiding it? It's invisible. Therefore, Satan is an asset, not a liability, because he shows forth the purpose of Yahweh according to the pattern. And it's not until that veil is rent in twain that Yahweh is revealed to you, that he is sitting on your throne, which is this gray and white matter type organ that we call our brain, just like the gray and white cloud that you have that would sit in the midst on the seat, the mercy seat on the Ark of the Covenant that was in the most holy place. You got a gray and white right there, and you got a gray and white right here. It's a type and shadow. And that law was placed in that Ark of the Covenant. And according to this new covenant, upon the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension, and outpouring of the Holy Spirit of Yahshua the Messiah, there is a new law. We took it out of this. We got rid of it. We took it out of this Ark of the Covenant here. We don't got to pitch tents out in the middle of the wilderness and sacrifice turtle doves and rams and whatever to the high priest and the low priest to make atonement for our sin. There is a new law. It's not written in pen and ink. It's not Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Acts of the Apostles, and Revelations, and what have you. First, second, third John, and first and second Peter. That is not the New Testament. That is not the New Covenant. The New Testament is Yahshua written in your heart and mind, in your consciousness. What we're doing down here at these schools, preaching the true gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, is we're baptizing you. But we're not doing it with water. You don't see no water nowhere in here except for in the bottles in the office. You can feel free to have one. They're free if you're thirsty. But we're drinking that water. We're not pouring it over nobody. We're not dunking nobody in no water. We are baptizing each and every one of you who comes down here in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And how we're doing that is we are immersing you in the truth about him, who he is, and how he actually exists. The first aim of this school is to help you find and know Yahweh for who he is and how he actually exists, so that you can avoid exalting yourself and finding yourself in the same place as Adonijah and Hammon and Ham and Nebuchadnezzar and Pharaoh. Ultimately, Satan. Because, see, according to the pattern of this tabernacle, and when we say in this moderation that we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this tabernacle. And when you understand coming down to this school that Yahweh is spirit and he is the only spirit in operation. You got one spirit in operation here, but you got two mysteries. You got a mystery of righteousness. You got a mystery of iniquity. And Satan, that mystery of iniquity, he has all of the qualities, and like we were just reading about in Ezekiel, he's got all of these qualities, but he perverts them right to his own gain so that he can exalt himself, so that he can be like the Most High, because he can't be the Most High.
Right.
Because he is actually the creature. And he is hiding the reality of the Creator. We are casting out demons in this school. If you can understand the things that we're talking about here, you will no longer be corrupted by the things that you thought that you knew. Coming into this school, you will be made. You'll take the corruptible must put on incorruption. Mm-hmm. Where is it in the book? It says there will not be this change will not take place unless there be a falling away first. Our theories, concepts, and opinions must be cast into the lake. The 10th aim of this school is to inherit eternal life. Now, not tomorrow, not when you die. You know, I remember when I was in church, I wanted to go to heaven. That's when I came into this school, I still wanted to go to heaven. I was living in hell. I was in a living hell. I mean, there was, you know, I wanted to be the biggest, baddest thug out there, the coolest. You know, I wanted to exalt myself so that, you know, I could be powerful and have a legacy. And that's what Satan is trying to do, is he's trying to build a legacy to go on. So when that man who is exalting himself takes off the flesh, his son can take over and rule here on and have a mighty kingdom and be powerful above all the rest of the men out here in the world. That is Satan that is trying to create that legacy for their children. That is the mystery of iniquity that's doing that. Yahweh told those Jews when they went out there into out of Egypt, just carrying everything that they could take with them, that he would provide for them. And he showed them that he would provide for them. There was no food out there for them. He rained down manna. He gave them quail. He's a provider. He gave them a law. He thundered down a law. They said, all that this that you say we'll do. That was a marriage. The children of Israel were the bride. They're Yahweh's bride. And Satan would creep in and try to deceive them every which way that he could. He was trying to take the bride. And they couldn't defend for themselves. They could not complete that law that was given to them. It necessitated Yahweh himself, the husbandman. We say it in a moderation that the self-same spirit that we express on this cloud, in this cloudy-like substance, Yahweh not being a cloud, but just not having any particular shape or form, because he wills to be what he wills to be, Ayah, Asher, Ayah, he took on shape and form in the likeness and image of a man, and then he put on a physical body. And that's what he did right here with Yahshua the Messiah. Walking the earth plane. He gave his bride a law. They couldn't follow the law. So it necessitated him to come and complete it so that that law could be taken out of the way and it could usher in a new covenant where that law would be written in your heart and mind and not by meats and drinks, not by meeting up and having Passover suppers and carnal ordinances and water baptisms and so on and so forth. We got a new covenant, and Yahweh himself provided this one, this sacrifice. Yahshua the Messiah, his only begotten son. Ain't no other. But that anointed cherub that covereth will have you thinking that there's billions and billions and billions of sons and daughters roaming the planet, and there are none of them are connected with God. But as I often reference in the first chapter of John, where it speaks upon that word being Yahweh and that word being being with Yahweh and being Yahweh and that word being the light that lighteth all men. Mm-hmm. He is the breath of life. There are first John 5 and 7, please. King James Version.
1 John 5 and 7.
Yes.
For there are three that bear record in heaven.
Read.
The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And these three are one.
These three are one. We talk about the pattern that everything in the universe is made and structured according to this tabernacle pattern. One, two, three. The Father, the Word, read that again.
For there are three that bear record in heaven, mm-hmm. the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one.
The Father, which is pure spirit abstract. The Word, which is that pure spirit taken on shape and form. And the Holy Spirit, which is that shape and form in righteousness. Because you also got the mystery of iniquity over here. That is a perverse shape and form. You don't want to forget about that guy. Because that's what we come in here that's in our way. That anointed cherub, that cover. Go ahead and read.
And there are three that bear witness on earth.
Because the visible explains the invisible. So there's got to be three that bear witness on earth. Read. Mm-hmm.
The spirit. The water.
The water.
And the blood.
And the blood.
And these three agree in one.
Now, anybody in this room can vouch for that.
That's right.
Because at some point in time, you had to have something, a drink of water to give you some energy to move around, you know, get those joints loosened up and whatnot. Each and every one of us right now is inspired. We're breathing in the oxygen that, and the root word of that is spirit. And that's inspiration that our physical body, that oxygen mixes with that blood and that water in our physical body and gives us life. And if you don't got the blood, you're going to pass out. You ever go donate blood and you try to stand up? Whoo, you're going to pass out. If you lose too much blood, if somebody cuts you open, you lose too much blood. You can drink as much Gatorade and water as you want to. If you lose too much blood, you're going down. You lose too much water, you going down. You lose too much oxygen, you going down.
That's right.
And that is confirmation that what John was writing in the book makes some sense. And this is before we knew all about science and the anatomy and whatnot. Okay. Yeah. This is thousands of years ago that this was being written. And it's still true to this day.
That's right.
Before modern technology. But you got that old boy, the devil, have you thinking that you are something. But the reality of it is Yahweh is the provider that provides for you life and breath.
That's right.
And everything. Mm-hmm. And you can't get outside of him. And if you were to get outside of him, you would cease to exist.
You can't.
It's utterly impossible because Yahweh is eternal. And eternity has no beginning. As far back as you can go in your little drawn up mind, Yahweh goes further. As far as you can predict in the future, Yahweh goes further because he is the ultimate source of everything. That's why you got up here on this chart these rings, and they go from eternity to eternity. It's a round trip. But when you don't understand, when you don't know, you think, oh, we going this way and we drawing it out in this linear and fashion. That is a carnal mind. You look eternity to eternity. We arguing all the time about how, oh, the earth is 6,000 years old, you know, it's billions of years old, or it's or it's trillions of years old or whatever, but the reality, it's right there in the book, and it's been there the whole time, that the earth and the world was created in eternity. But, you know, Satan's got to have he's got to put everything into a box. He's got to make everything make sense on a physical level, in a carnal level. Because Revelations 12 and I'll be done. 8. See, he can't get up into heaven no more, so he can't know nothing about Yahweh. But go ahead and let's read over there in Revelations 12th chapter.
12 and
there
8.
Was war in heaven.
Mm-hmm. And there was war in heaven.
Right.
Michael and his angels fought against the dragon.
Mm-hmm.
And the dragon fought and his angels.
Right.
And prevailed not.
That neither dragon was, didn't prevail. Read.
Neither was their place found anymore in heaven.
Stop. Neither was his place found anymore in heaven. There was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought, and the dragon and his angels fought, and that dragon didn't prevail, and he was cast out. Just like what I was just talking about, our theories, our concepts, our opinions of things that we think we know are being cast out. If you can accept the truth, then you will no longer be a victim of your own opinions, of the opinions that have been imposed upon you, that your mama taught you, and your mama's taught her, and so on and so forth, down to through the legacies of mankind. And you realize in eternity, it's always now in eternity. Just Thursday, Dr. Alanese was talking about that. Eternity is now. Mm-hmm. It's beautiful. It's such a beautiful thing when you can understand how everything is made according to this pattern. And you are what you're looking for. Well, go ahead and read.
10. And the great dragon was cast out,
mm-hmm.
that old serpent called the devil,
right.
and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world.
He deceiveth the whole world with his theories, concepts, and opinions, and his ideas of the way he thinks things should be. Read.
He was cast out into the earth.
He was cast out into the earth. The anointed cherub that covereth.
Oh, boy.
I'm done for. That's enough for today. We're out of time.
Beautiful.
If anything was gotten out of what was said today, all praises be to Yahweh Elohim through his only begotten son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. That will conclude today's class. Thank you for your time. Thank you for allowing me to take the time to go through this thing. Do we have any announcements? No? Okay.
Go. Annual
donations letters are ready, and they're getting mailed out to those. And if you have, if you're here, you can pick them up from her. They're ready. So that is a definitely important announcement, because you don't want to keep the tax man waiting. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truthfully the place to learn something truthful about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Yeah,
it was
all right.
Yeah, yeah.
That was good.
Yes, it was. And how are you?
I'm good.
Good.